Hello everyone, my name is Jacopo Bartiromo and today I will be talking about the improvements in the Traffic Manager, which is the module that controls vehicles inside the Carla simulation. We will begin by briefly introducing the Traffic Manager, why it was developed and what is its main objective. Then we will dive into the possibilities for users to customize their own traffic inside of the Carla simulation, while also discussing some improvements and showing examples of our latest features, such as hybrid mode. After this, we will be moving on to the details of the internal design of this module and also look into algorithms and strategies that we will adopt to provide realistic traffic behaviors. Then, we will look into some more advanced usages of Traffic Manager, and finally, we'll discuss some limitations of the current implementation, analyzing future work and Traffic Manager 2.0, which will be coming along with Carla 0.9.10. First of all, let's discuss a bit over what is the Traffic Manager, why it was developed, and how it works. So since Carla 0.9.7, the Traffic Manager has replaced the former server-side autopilot to offload some work from the server side to the clients by exploiting the Waypoint API. Its main purpose is to improve the way cars roam around the towns while giving users the option to customize the traffic like never before. It is currently being used for background traffic support, given that it can manage a fleet of vehicles and can be configured to implement different behaviors, such as keeping safety distance or execute lane changes. Here we can see a basic example showing how to run the Traffic Manager inside the Carla simulation. First of all, we execute the command seen on the right side to launch the simulation, and a window containing the view over a town will immediately pop up. Now we can run any script, for instance, one of our examples, spawnNPC.py, as you can see on the left side, which also allows us to choose the number of vehicles and walkers, and also the model of the car if we want to. This will quickly put some life into the city, with all the cars being controlled by the Traffic Manager module in all their decisions and actions, as you can see in the last seconds of this short video. So the script spawnNPC.py, which can be found in the examples folder, gives a general idea of how to run the Traffic Manager and has different arguments to select the number of vehicles and walkers to create, but also contains more advanced stuff, which is related to the Traffic Manager, that we can see later on. Any user can change this script to easily customize their own Traffic Manager. So let's look into customization a little bit more. We allow users to change their traffic behavior by adding just a few lines of code, which we will show in the next slides. We allow a set of different parameters to be adjusted, such as the distance to leading vehicle, allowing the speed above limit, the percentage of velocity reduction from speed limit, the chance of respecting the keep right rule, the chance of running a traffic light, of ignoring pedestrians, and of ignoring other vehicles, forcing a lane change, and tuning lane changes on and off. Also here we can see how in four lines of code you can launch a client, run the Traffic Manager, and set two different parameters, the global distance to leading vehicle and the percentage of velocity reduction from the current speed limit. Let's show some other examples. In the first one, we add a 5% chance for every vehicle to ignore a traffic light or another car that it could be colliding with. To do so, we get every vehicle ID from the list of successfully spawned vehicles. Then we apply this change for each one of them. But we could also do it on a percentage of car or on a specific model. In the second one instead, we force a lane change on a random vehicle, although it will still check for possible collisions with incoming vehicles. In this video, then, we will visualize what happens when changing some parameters of the car of Traffic Manager inside the simulation. This first example is showing how the vehicles stop at a different distance according to which value is specified. In the first case, it's of 3 meters, while in the latter one, is of 1 meter. This also affects the safety distance, because vehicles will keep a different minimum distance between themselves and the leading car according to the specified value. All cars are respecting the rules of the road. Then, we unleash chaos into the city by setting all vehicles to ignore other cars, traffic lights and pedestrians, luckily without cluttering this particular intersection. Finally, an example showing how keep right rule affects the traffic on highways, with vehicles first distributing equally over the lanes with 0% chance of respecting right rule, while then being all on the most right lane when it's at 100%. During development of CARLA 0.9.9, we mainly focused on improvement of the traffic manager in terms of computational efficiency. We applied some minor changes to the internal data structures, which we will see later on, such as caching geometry comparison results to save up time, and also use waypoint binning to group different ones into a smaller number of pins to expedite searching for the target waypoint. But most importantly, we introduced hybrid mode, which allows the user to run the traffic manager with vehicle physics disabled, except for around the Ego vehicle. The following video shows vehicles with physics disabled tagged with a blue square, the Ego vehicle tagged with a red square, and when inside the area of influence, vehicles with physics on tagged with a green square. Vehicle physics are a big bottleneck for the simulation, so in hybrid mode they can be disabled and are only enabled in a radius around any Ego vehicle. Since physics are not active, cars move by teleportation. However, not all physics are deactivated, such as basic calculation for linear acceleration. By doing so, the position update and vehicle speed still look realistic, and it guarantees that when a vehicle enables or disables its physics, the transition is still fluid. There are two parameters for hybrid mode. One is the radius that states the proximity area around any Ego vehicle where physics are enabled. The other one is the number of vehicles with the role name Hero that will act as the center of the radius. If there is none, all vehicles will have disabled physics. If there are many, the radius will be considered for all of them, and that will create different areas of influence with physics enabled. Here we can see how to set hybrid mode from any script and optionally choose a radius. Let's now analyze the internal design of the traffic manager to understand how each vehicle is being controlled by it. This loop shows in a very simple way how the traffic manager operates on each frame. The blue rectangle represents stages, which implement independent functionalities to generate and apply actuation signals to vehicles. The green ones are the separated modules that aid the stages by providing and processing information. The red arrows represent messengers, which facilitate asynchronous communication between stages. Meanwhile, the black arrows represent the non-concurrent data flow coming from the modules. The localization stage is responsible for maintaining horizon of waypoint ahead of the vehicle for it to follow, while also managing lane change decisions and modifying the trajectory accordingly. To allow this, the waypoint in memory map creates at runtime a cached version of the current town's waypoint connections and allows the localization stage to reduce the computational costs by eliminating calls to the simulator. The collision stage is in charge of checking for possible crashes with other vehicles or walkers along each vehicle's trajectory. The traffic light stage provides the information about the traffic lights at junctions, while the motion planner stage takes care of aggregating information from the various pass stages and actuation signals from the PID controller to make decisions on how to move the vehicle to follow its trajectory safely. Finally, the batch control stage receives actuation signals such as throttle, brake, and steer from the motion planner stage and communicates these signals to the simulator in batches to control every vehicle's movement. This architecture shows and allows us to build algorithms and data structures in a very organized way that can be located inside one stage or distributed around several of them, according to what we need to achieve. Each stage also implements different algorithms and strategies to achieve realistic traffic behaviors. We will be showing a few examples. The CARLA API provides the opportunity to query for points on the OpenDrive map given a nearby location. We're exploiting these features by taking discrete samples of the map with a predetermined resolution and storing the finite set of waypoints as a connected vector graph on the client side. This helps a lot in reducing latency when querying the map, since we don't query the server for this operation during execution. As part of the localization stage, to improve computational efficiency, especially at intersections, Each vehicle only looks at one grid away in all directions to find potential dangers. So the collisions between bounding boxes are only considered within those grids. The blue lines represent the Cartesian grid boundaries, while the red ones are potential collision detected. However, using relative localization with Cartesian grids, we were also detecting many vehicles that might not be relevant. For example, those in opposite lanes. For a more driving contextual detection of surrounding traffic, we are using spatial grids that align with the road network. Vehicles with paths, the black curves that we can see in the video, that have common geodesic grids are detected by each other. This also helps improving efficiency in the collision stage, as there are less potentially dangerous vehicles to consider. A traffic behavior-related algorithm we've introduced is called the intersection anticipation. Deadlocks were caused by cars cluttering a junction, so we can see the first car checking if there's enough space to go through the junction, which is true, so it keeps going, while the second one had a car blocking its path and stopped, waiting for it to move away. One of the more visible differences from the former autopilot is that now we have lane changes happening in the traffic manager. Those can happen for several reasons, such as overtaking or avoiding tailgating, but also because the current lane is more cluttered than a viable one right next to our vehicle, or also to respect the keep right rule. To check for potential collisions, a bounding box is computed, although they are not shown in this video, with its length stretched or reduced according to the current velocity profile of the car, in order to make sure that we won't incur in any collision. Finally, in this video, we visualize these geodesic bounding boxes, how they stretch according to the velocity of the vehicle, and how they detect a collision with a leading vehicle, telling the car to adjust its speed in order to avoid a potential crash. The bounding boxes extend following the trajectory of the vehicle in order to identify possible collisions in their path with both cars and pedestrians. Now let's go through some of the advanced usages and features of the traffic manager. In synchronous mode, the simulation will not execute the following step until the client sends a tick, and the traffic manager will only process one frame per tick. This mode is vital when precision is required, especially when dealing with different elements retrieving information, which can slow down the execution. Here we can see an example of how to activate synchronous mode with the traffic manager and the Carla simulation. Another important usage is when we want to run multiple traffic managers, for whatever reason that might be needed. First, multi-client. More than one client operates on the same traffic manager created in a single port. The first one will be a traffic manager server, which will be in charge of many tasks, such as running the synchronous mode. The rest will be traffic manager clients connecting to it, and they will shut down when the traffic manager does so. This could be useful if we want to work with two scripts that might be two different things, but we want both of them to be under the same traffic manager. Then, multi-traffic manager, so different traffic manager instances with different ports assigned. This can be especially useful when we want an heterogeneous traffic, having a clear distinction through the customizable parameters for each traffic manager. Finally, multi-simulation is where there are more than one Carla server running at the same time. It is independent from the traffic manager itself, but useful when we want to run parallel instances to save up time. The example above runs two Carla simulations in parallel, A and B. In each of them, a traffic manager server is created independently from the other. Then, simulation A could run a multi-client traffic manager, while simulation B is running a multi-traffic manager, or no traffic manager at all. Finally, let's explore some of the limitations of the current traffic manager and dive in on the future work of this model. The chosen design, although very useful for several reasons, has been proven to have some limitations. First, the highly encapsulated data structures that might limit shared access by components and external API calls. Then, the staggered data flow pipeline that suffers a fixed multi-frame latency. Also, the design is not flexible for modifications when it comes to the structure of the loop. Another limitation is the absence of structures that allow for multi-threading. For this, we need to move from a per-frame structure to a per-vehicle one, allowing a thread pool to handle the vehicles. Also, some bottlenecks in terms of computational efficiency, such as the two frequent queries for information, coming directly from the Carla simulation, such as vehicle position or velocities, which have concurrency protection when trying to access them. Furthermore, the simulation state from Carla is updated at the client side using a locking mechanism on Word, and reading the snapshot repeatedly is definitely a bottleneck. Finally, localization and collision stage take up most of the time resources and cannot be parallelized right now. To overcome these limitations, we came up with a new Traffic Manager 2.0, which is actually already under review for the next Carla release. Also, future work includes making the Traffic Manager a library to expand the range of situations where it can be used. Extend it with the new and improved Traffic Light module and include a deterministic mode, allowing the user to recreate the same exact traffic across different instances. Let's take a look at the new components of Traffic Manager 2.0, which is set to solve most of the limitations we have just listed. The Agent Lifecycle and State Management, or short ALSM, now will be the component at the beginning of the Traffic Manager execution flow. It scans the world for all the alive actors, then performs a cleanup of the deleted ones, or allocates the space for a new one. Then it retrieves and updates the state of all the vehicles currently being tracked. All subsequent components now will query this structure instead of the simulation, or passing around messages for position and velocity vectors for any vehicles. Direct calls types are isolated inside this module, and this is particularly helpful in making the subsequent components agnostic to whether or not physics are enabled for any vehicle, and reducing computational costs. The feeder is a queue of all the actor IDs belonging to our traffic manager, that we will then that will be picked from the threads in the thread pool, each of them with functions for localization, hazard, planner, and controller. Appropriate synchronization barriers are placed to avoid resource contention and ensure timely frame completion. This design also removes possible synchronous mode bottlenecks, since all the data from the current frame is being processed by the pool within the same frame duration. Path buffers are a complex structure that update waypoint queues representing paths of the vehicle. It also internally updates the vehicle tracking logic to identify geodesic grid position and waypoint currently occupied by vehicles. This logic is moved away from the localization stage to isolate and protect it from improper access. In this new design, all components that need information about the path have better direct protected access to this structure instead of relying on previous components in the flow to pass along relevant samples of path buffers, such as target waypoint for PID, buffer copying for collision stage to apply path polygon construction, etc. This also greatly improves logical separation of functionality in the system, as access to path buffers has been a major bottleneck for all previous designs of Traffic Manager. For example, the localization stage was earlier responsible for path selection and lane changing, which should rightly be responsibility of the planner stage. This can now be easily achieved with the new design. Finally, the command aggregator collects all Carla commands from various threads of the thread pool and constructs a batch command to be sent to the server, like the batch control stage did before. Once all full commands batches are constructed, the batch command is applied to the server with appropriate synchronous asynchronous RPC calls based on the mode of operation. This is it. Thanks for your attention, and feel free to comment down or ask any question regarding the Traffic Manager, whether on Discord or on the Carla forum.